everyone, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. We are going to take you on a tour of our garden, and we're going to focus on trees in our garden. This will be part one. Some of you may remember early this spring, we put in some new little trees to replace the two maple trees that we had to take down. This is a paper bark maple. It gets 30 feet tall, about 25 feet wide, so it'll be big, but it grows slowly. It likes zones that are obviously our zone 5 through 7, and it likes sun, but it'll tolerate partial shade.
It definitely has maple leaves.
Yes, and you can see the bark right here, how it's beginning to peel off, like a birch tree, like you would think of a birch tree.
Well, don't they call that exfoliating?
Yes, they do.
Yeah, and I can just picture this tree when it's really big.
Oh, like it'll be fun. Yes.
The birch trees where they have that unique bark feature.
Mm-hmm. And it's also, believe it or not, a popular with the bonsai enthusiasts.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting tree for
sure. Well, I don't think we're going to bonsai this one.
No.
Well, let's go look at the next tree on our list.
Yes, let's do that. Our next tree is also a maple. This is an October glory maple. And this one will get very tall. This one can get 50 feet tall and 30 feet wide. So with the two maples together, we may have a shade garden eventually.
Like the battling of the maples?
Oh, I hope not.
I hope
not. They like zones 3 through 5 and full sun.
Well, definitely is in full sun.
Yes. It'll turn reddish in the fall, and it's a very pretty tree.
It really is.
Lots of shade.
Yeah. So what's our next tree on the list?
Let's go and see.
Okay.
Now this is a very interesting plant because this has been a bush, and it is now a tree. So you may wonder, well, what's the difference between a tree and a bush? If the plant is woody and it's over 10 feet tall, it's considered a tree. So in its transformation, this purple leaf smoke plant has turned into a tree.
Well, I think those blossoms, first of all, this year have been absolutely spectacular. I mean, so many people have stopped and asked, what is that thing?
Yes, you know? Yes, and this is its finest year yet.
Yeah.
They like zone 4 through 8, and they're just very dramatic. Now, right now, the leaves don't look that purple, but they were purple earlier in the year.
Well, here's an example right here.
Yes.
Because this is a little shrub that's coming out from the bottom.
That's right. Those we will be trimming off because we don't want it to start thinking it's going to be a bush again.
And this branch, we believe a deer had actually gotten in here and actually cracked it, and it was just lying on the ground, so we had to amputate
right.
it.
But these little blossoms here.
Oh, that was even frillier.
These,
now it's
yes.
on the tail end.
And this is where the seeds are. You can see the seeds. They're very tiny.
Yeah.
So who knows? We may find little ones coming up.
Now, doesn't the definition of a tree also talk about the number of branches or something that come from it?
No, it's got to be woody, and it has to be at least 10 feet tall.
Like Toy Story?
No.
Oh. Okay, well, but there's another tree behind you, right?
This is the Bosnian Pine. And you can tell it's a pine because the needles are so very tall.
Hmm.
And it is it can grow 40 feet tall, and it can get 12 feet wide. Likes a zone right here, 4 through 8. It likes sun. It grows very slowly, and it stays in this pyramidal kind of shape.
So it probably wasn't a good idea to plant these two trees quite this close together.
Well, considering the purple leaf grows quickly and the Bosnian pine grows slowly, I think we're okay.
At least during our lifetime.
Yes.
Well, what's next on the list?
Oh, I think it's going to be this one. The European Tricolor Beech, which we have featured many times in our videos.
Edges are kind of crispy because of this unusually hot, right. Dry summer.
Yes, and they do enjoy more moist soil. This one can get 25 to 35 feet tall and 25 feet wide. It's our zone again, 4 through 7. And it sort of likes partial shade, so with these trees around it, it's happy.
Well, we've given it a fairly good drip line, and we do keep it watered. But what amazes me is when we wake up in the morning and we look out the window.
Especially in the spring, when the sun comes shining onto it, it almost glows. It's almost a neon pink, and you can see it wherever you are in the yard with this pink glow to it.
It's like it's on fire.
Yes. And then in the fall, it'll just kind of all turn to a more burgundy color. Yes.
If the sun doesn't bleach them all out and burn them to a crisp, I don't know. Amazing. I really do. I know we searched for this tree for the longest time.
Yes,
I mean, years and years and years, and
yes.
We're fortunate to find one.
We had seen a couple in a yard and knew that this was one we really wanted.
Okay, well, let's go see what's next on the list.
Okay. We have several crabapple trees on our yard, and this was the first one we had. It's called a Profusion Crabapple tree. It's a very hardy tree. It can grow up to 20 feet tall and 15 feet wide, but we have chosen to turn it into a lollipop tree just by shaping it. And it was easily shaped. It didn't resist being shaped at all. It obviously has fruit, crabapple fruit, which the birds love. And since it's not in a walkway, there is not a problem with a mess of it. It's, like I said, hardy. It doesn't get diseases. It's salt tolerant, drought tolerant, and deer resistant.
Well, I've had fun keeping it into a lollipop shape over the years. It was really easy when it was small.
Yes.
Now I have to bring the ladder out to shape it, but
my high school art teacher said don't be drawing a tree looking like a lollipop. Well, Mrs. Vaughn, my husband made one. This is one of our new trees. And it's called a Limelight Hydrangea Tree. It's supposed to get 6 feet tall and 5 feet wide. And these palms, possibly 8 inches across. So this is the first year. We didn't think it was even going to bloom this year because we just planted it. But you can see that it has bloomed. And it's very pretty. It's white, kind of a whitey, creamy white with little hints of pink to it.
It is pretty.
It's very pretty. And it's drought resistant and very hardy, especially in our area. So we hope that it lives for a long, long time because it is unique and it's pretty.
Just like you.
Aw, thank you.
You blend.
Oh, thanks. It's not even fall. This is a Whitespire Birch Clump. So it comes with multiple stems, as you can see. It has a chalky color to the bark. It does not exfoliate. That's the way it stays all the time. And in the summer, it's green, and in the fall, it's turning yellow. And I'm hoping this is not
an indication.
Indication that it's fall, but it is cold today compared to what it has been. It's deer resistant and urban tolerant, whatever that means. And I have been talking about zones that these trees are happy in. Obviously, this is zone 5.
IB.
Yes, and so there is a range. they're, you know, it can be a little colder and a little warmer. So right now, full sun is something it loves though.
Well, I'll be scrolling, you know, the names of the trees below, so if people like that kind of a tree and would like to add it to their gardens, at least they'll have an idea to start their research.
Yes, and we used to have a paper bark birch. Mm-hmm. That one was not as hardy as this one. This one seems to be a little bit hardier variety of birch. Something to keep in mind.
Yeah, cool.
Again, this is one of our newest trees. And at the moment, it's not looking real happy. This is called a Marilee Crabapple tree. It's known to be very tall. It can get 20 feet tall, 25 feet tall, but it'll only get about 10 feet wide. It enjoys having a lot more moisture than some plants. So we have been taking special care to add more moisture to it. It was a hard year, but I noticed that it does have some little apples on it. So even though it's been struggling a bit, it does have apples.
Yes, it does.
Good job, tree.
Well, we have used tree tone on it.
Yes.
We've made sure it gets plenty of water.
Yep.
Especially during the really hot, dry times. So we're doing our little part, and now it's up to the tree and its roots to start taking hold. But it does have pretty blossoms in spring. We have seen it.
Yes, it does. It starts out with a really bright red bud, and then they open to be white. These three bushes are dwarf Alberta spruce trees.
Now wait.
Trees, yes.
You just called them bushes.
They look like a bush right now only because we chose to have them look like this. They can get 10 to 13 feet tall, but we have chosen to make them into topiaries and keep them smaller.
So is it a tree or a bush?
Both. But you'll notice how dense this foliage is. I mean, it's like a scrubby brush. It's really prickly and dense, and we have chosen to make it look like a more oriental
topiary.
Right.
Yeah.
And sometimes we need to do that because they do have a tendency to get burned in the winter by sun and by wind. So sometimes we have to take some of the branches off, and so we made it into a topiary to make it look pretty.
So now I'm going to go to bed at night wondering, is this a tree or is this a bush?
It could be a tree, but we chose to make it a bush.
Okay, but we're including it in trees in our garden.
We are, because it could be a tree.
Oh, okay. Well, I could be a tree too. You could plant me.
No, you're not 10 feet tall. I'm sorry.
Well, so I wouldn't even qualify?
And I'm not going to prune you, so you're going to stay.
Well, thank you.
Now, behind me is our flowering cherry tree. Flowering cherry tree means it's not going to give us any fruit. It's just flowers. And the flowers are beautiful. It likes to have full sun, and it's only supposed to get 20 feet tall, which is almost there, I think. We've had to do some trimming on it because it was trying to take over a little bit.
Oh, it was growing into the arbor.
Yes, it was.
And that's not good.
And you're competing here. Full sun, very pretty in the spring, no fruit.
And this was not the best time to be pruning a tree either, but we saw what was happening, and it was either the arbor or the tree, and we opted for both.
And if you'll notice, if we can get a little closer, the bark is very interesting.
Well, let's go over and look at it.
Behind this honeysuckle?
Yep.
Okay, so you'll notice the bark. It has ridges.
Well, it's actually a circular kind of texture to it. Now, I think this tree has been here close to 10 years.
Yes.
So, and again, constant pruning.
Yes.
Constant trimming. Well, that one was done, I think, last fall.
Last fall, yes.
So. Another cool tree in the garden.
It is.
So what's next on the list?
Next on the list is another crabapple tree.
Oh, well, let's go take a look at that one.
Okay. This is another one of our new trees. This is called a coral burst crabapple tree. And we picked this one because it only gets 10 feet tall, but it can get 15 feet wide. And we wanted something that was wider, so it was going to create more shade over here where there used to be a lot of shade. It's made to have beautiful blossoms. I shouldn't say it's made. It has double pink blossoms. So it's very, very pretty when it blossoms. And all of our trees did blossom this year, even though we just planted them this spring.
Well, this is one of five new trees this spring.
Yes.
So after having to have those two huge maples taken down.
And it's very hardy. It's resistant to a lot of things, so it's a good, reliable tree.
Well, this tree fascinates me, especially being in the center of two tall trees. You've got the Marilee, which we just spoke of,
which is
over there.
Tall and skinny.
Yep, and then this wide one, and we'll soon be talking about the goalpost.
This is another flowering cherry tree, which means it's not going to have fruit, it's only going to have flowers. And it's a weeping flowering cherry.
Does that mean it's crying a lot?
No.
Oh.
So you see this, the trunk is like the other flowering cherry, that same textured trunk. But what was put on the top was
grafted. So that's the rootstock, right?
Right, that's the root.
Okay.
And then it was grafted up on the top to be weeping. Now we have to keep after this one because some of the branches decided they don't want to weep. So we have to take out the vertical branches when they start going awry. It has very delicate pink flowers. I know one year it looked like an umbrella with pink lace on it. It was absolutely gorgeous. Mm-hmm. This spring, it didn't because we had been trimming it a lot just to get it under control. And because it's grafted, if any sprouts start coming off of the trunk or below the grafting, you want to take those off. You don't want to encourage those.
So, should I bring my guitar out and allow it to gently weep?
No. This one gets about 15 feet tall and it can get 15 feet wide, so no weeping on a guitar.
I'll put my guitar away then.
Okay. This was a tree I have admired because our neighbor has one for years. It's an eastern redbud. And I don't know why they call it a redbud, because it has vibrant purple flowers on it in the spring. It's absolutely wonderful, and it didn't disappoint us. It had purple flowers, even though it had been newly planted.
Well, it was amazing to see the purple, the pink, the white.
I mean, it was
quite a spring sight to see, and I can't wait for these to mature.
Yes, and it's known for its unique structure, as well as its purple flowers. And look at the beautiful heart-shaped leaves.
Well, that's appropriate for our garden.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Keep the love growing.
Yes.
So now that you're done admiring your eastern redbud, where are we heading next?
Now we're going to a dwarf Macintosh apple tree.
That's only about 12 feet away.
Yes, it is. So let's hightail over there. Now this tree is only supposed to get 8 to 12 feet tall. Somehow I don't think it realizes that it's supposed to be dwarf, but you can see it is full of apples this year. I think it's happy that we cut down the maple trees.
Absolutely. I mean,
just look at them.
I'm looking at hundreds
of
apples on this tree. And we probably should have maybe done some thinning.
We didn't realize it was going to get this loaded. Last year maybe it had
two apples.
Right. Now Macintosh apples, great for baking, great for pies. They're red on the outside and white on the inside, and they're kind of sweet and tart at the same time.
Well, not only do you have one,
yes,
but you have another one on the other side of the driveway.
And
let's go look at that one.
Why did you plant these here, Richard?
Well, you know, we had a lot of high school students that would walk down, up and down the street while they're going to the high school, uh-huh. which is a couple of blocks away.
Right.
And I wanted to put a sign up once it had apples saying that, high school students, please pick an apple for yourself and one for your teacher. So we can have hundreds of high school students stop by this year.
And I think our pruning had a lot to do
absolutely.
With how prolific they are now, because we were really kind of gung-ho on our pruning this spring, and it's definitely made a difference.
Well, that apple orchard that we went to last fall, which we're going to do a video with Roy, the owner.
Rim's Edge.
And it just blew my mind. I mean, he had 6,000 apple trees that were as full as the one, even fuller than the ones we're looking at now.
Very inspirational.
And you could eat while you pick, all you want.
This tiny tree behind me is a spruce tree. Ha ha. This can get 60 to 200 feet tall if you let it, if the conditions are right. We've often thought of this one as a city Christmas tree because it was so perfectly shaped. We moved this one from another part of the yard. And
when it was a baby.
When it was a tiny baby.
And even then we still had to use a dolly because it probably weighed with the root ball at least 300 pounds, maybe more.
Yes. We don't know what kind of spruce tree is. We only know it's not a blue spruce because it's definitely not blue. It loves this weather zone, and it will have small little cones on it.
So, ice cream cones?
No, spruce cones.
Spruce cones.
Not pine cones. Spruce cones.
Okay.
So we have this one. We have another one over there, and then there is a tiny one that has planted itself.
Well, let's go over and look at those.
You want to see the tiny one?
Yep.
Now here's the medium-sized one that we moved when it was a baby, and you can see how small the cones are when they're falling off, because this is a time of year they want to drop their seeds and start planting themselves.
Which?
As did this one.
Well, this grew by itself from one of those.
And it's kind of oddly shaped because I was going to trim it. I was going to make it more of a circular shape.
So you messed this one up?
I did mess it. I took off the top.
That explains it.
So I'm going to continue trimming and making it cute again.
I couldn't figure out why this tree was so strangely shaped. Well, you've answered my question.
Well, I was going to make it even smaller, and you said, no, let's keep it here because it's kind of a deterrent to the deer to come into our yard.
Yeah.
So, it's a work in progress. Again, this could get 60 to 200 feet tall if you let it. I'm not going to let this one get that tall.
I don't think our neighbors would be very happy if it invaded their fence.
No, they won't.
So we'll have to do our due diligence to make sure we're not invading other spaces.
Yes. These are Elberta with an E peach trees. Now you might want to say, well, they both don't look anything like a tree. No, they aren't, not yet. These came from peach pits that fell off our original Elberta peach trees that we had probably 8 to 10 years ago.
Yeah.
The Elberta peach tree is hardy for this area, and they can live up to 20 years. They're not a really long-lived tree, but they are so
prolific
and give you so much fruit in the time that they do live.
I remember just one of our trees gave us over 300 peaches that one year.
And we're talking Georgia peach size.
Yeah.
Absolutely delicious free stone, which means if you cut it in half, both sides fall away from the stone and you don't have to be digging around trying to get it out. So These are homegrown from our own...
From our own pits?
Yeah, our own pits. And in the orchard, we have a new one that we bought 3 years ago.
Well, let's go in and look at that one.
Okay. 3 years ago, we bought this peach tree. Actually, we bought two. One of them didn't make it. But this one is just a magnificent tree. It's, again, an Elberta peach. But you can see how many peaches are on here. Now, we should, again, we should have thinned them a little bit so that there weren't quite so many on. The tree itself will do some thinning by dropping some of the fruit. But the branches are so full that we had to support them so that the branch didn't crack off.
Well, I like those little support units that you found online. I think we're going to need more of those.
Yes, and I like the way you modified how it goes into the ground to hold it steady without disturbing the whole trunk. Yeah. Again, very prolific. We gave it a little more structure by bracing up the trunk. We probably will put a third stake in later on, just to make sure it's steady in the ground.
Well, then in spring, we have a lot of pruning to do.
Right, and then in spring is when you do the trimming on peaches. From my reading, peaches don't like to be trimmed until they start budding. They're susceptible to a lot of diseases, and they're least susceptible when they start budding out. So that's when we'll be trimming any horizontal branches and anything that crosses, and anytime there's disease or damage, you can trim any tree. But for the most part, not until later.
Well, even though we lost one of our newly purchased peach trees, we have to show the other two additional. So we actually have five peach trees that came from seedlings from our original peach tree.
Those three that you saw out there, and then there's a couple behind Rick.
Well, let's go look at those.
Here's one of them. Again, this one's taller than myself, and I thought I saw a peach on here. Yep.
On this one? Oh, yeah.
There it is.
Sure enough. The first peach of this tree.
Yep.
Now, I have to tell you, when we planted this tree, I think it was this spring, wasn't it? Or was it last year?
It might be last fall.
I don't think it was. Well, it wasn't as tall as that cage, which is only maybe about 2.5-3 feet.
Yes.
And then, of course, you have another one.
And there's this one over here, which is just gone bonkers. Just look at it.
I mean,
it's amazing.
You have probably over a dozen peaches just on this tree.
Yes, and I can hardly wait until they start softening up so we can...
These are delicious. I love eating peaches right off the tree. Yes. I mean, give me a peach and I'll be a very happy man.
And like I said, this one is a freestone peach, which means it's not a cling peach, it's a freestone. So when you open it up, the stone, you can easily pick the stone out with your fingers.
I remember when the snow was flying and you'd go downstairs and come up and thaw something and then bring out a peach delight that made what snow.
And I made jam and jelly out of them. I mean, they're just yummy. Peach cobbler. But another tree that we bought is...
Oh, the 5-in-1 apple trees, yeah.
The 5-in-1 apple tree, and this one is going to town this year as well. This has five different kinds of apples on it. Again, it's a...
If I remember, it had Fuji, had Cortland, had Granny Smith, I think was the main...
rootstock.
Right? I'm thinking, did I say Macintosh?
Granny. See,
at one point, we used to have
little labels
on each branch. Yeah.
Where did they go?
Oh, here's one down here hanging. What does this one say? Fuji.
Fuji.
Oh, here's another one. Honeycrisp.
Honeycrisp, right.
Here's another one down there, which is Braeburn.
Braeburn.
That was another one.
That's the one, right.
So this is going to be fun because last year I think we had, what, two? Two apples?
Yes.
But you can see the weight. Again, I need more of those.
You need more braces.
Yeah.
Right.
Because these two branches are already
right. Well, they're
on top of each other.
Leaning on top. I even put a tomato cage in here to hold them
for
up.
For support.
Right. And then this octopusy thing looks, it's only because this cage, while sturdy as it was, the top circle came off.
We don't want somebody to get
so
poked
on. Right. Them. So I'm trying to keep it safe.
I thought you were being very clever.
Oh, thank you.
Except no. It needs to go under the tree.
We did notice that this year we do have little spots, and this I'm thinking is rust. Yeah. So this will be taken care of.
Well, we don't spray anything.
No,
I mean,
we don't.
We've never had the, I don't know, desire, but I know they talk about using copper spray, I think it is.
Copper is for funguses and that sort of thing, yeah. And also neem oil.
Oh, yeah.
Neem oil also okay. helps with that sort of thing. So this will be fun to see how many different apples we get off of it. And these are 5-in-1. That means one stock with four other kinds of apples
grafted.
They're right. grafted on here. So it's a unique tree. To say the least.
Well, I've seen 3-in-1 apple trees, and mm-hmm. when we first heard about 5-in-1, I thought, well, that was it. Wasn't there an artist who commissioned a whole grove of trees, I think it was in Washington, D.C., as an art exhibit where
yes.
he planted fruit for people who were going through that
wanted
particular garden?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That was so cool. I like that.
This is going to end part one of Trees in Our Garden. It's been fun looking at them all and remembering how we got started with them and anticipating what fun they'll be as they continue to grow. If you enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up. If you'd like to see more of our videos, perhaps that you haven't seen before, come over to wisconsingarden.com and look those up. Also, if you'd like to become part of our garden family, there is a subscribe button here if you aren't already a subscriber, and thank you if you are. When you subscribe, there's also a little bell up here that will notify you when a new video comes out, because stay tuned for part two of Trees in Our Garden. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.